What is 1 plus 1 equals to? It would be almost impossible to find a single human being on this planet who doesn't know the answer to this question. Even the people who never had any sort of formal education will confidently tell you that the answer is 2. But then why did Bertrand Russell and Alfred Whitehead have to use 370 pages to prove something as obvious as this? By the way, when you're asking this question, we are by default considering the base of the number system to be 10. To understand why Russell and Whitehead had to take so much trouble, we must first consider the situation mathematics was in during the last centuries. From the ancient time, mathematicians were working on different branches of mathematics such as geometry and arithmetic. During the 9th century, Ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi founded the branch of mathematics named algebra. During the 17th century, Isaac Newton and Gottfried Leibniz individually introduced the idea of calculus. But even after all those mathematical developments, something was really missing: the rigor. Mathematicians were working on different individual branches of mathematics, but there was no firm foundational pillar. For example, even though Newton and Leibniz invented calculus, they were mostly using it as a tool to solve problems, and there were lots of holes in their version of calculus. In 19th century, mathematicians like Augustin Louis Cauchy, Bernard Bolzano, Carl Weierstrass founded calculus in rigorous mathematical footing and gave birth to the mathematical discipline called real analysis, which is basically calculus on steroids. Another great development in foundation of mathematics is the development of set theory by George Cantor in 19th century. But even after all those developments, the foundation of mathematics was still quite shaky. The problem of not having a firm foundation is that it would be very difficult to generalize different concepts and show deeper connection between different branches of mathematics. Mathematics is not just a collection of different disconnected branches, is a study of more generalized ideas that depicts the profound connections between different seemingly disparate branches. As Freeman Dyson once said, mathematics is both great art and important science because it combines generality of concepts with depth of structures. To find this generalization, we have to define each and every term with extreme rigor and precision, no matter how obvious it seems. Bertrand Russell and Alfred Whitehead wanted to take the responsibility. Their goal was to define everything about mathematics in a very precise language of mathematical logic. They started from the ground up and developed all the axioms in their Principia Mathematica, which they wanted to be the Bible of the foundation of mathematics. Now the question is, did they actually succeed in putting mathematics on a firm foundation? I'm going to answer this question at the end of the video. Now to be clear, the way we are going to prove that 1 plus 1 equals to 2 is called formal proof. The goal of formal proof is not to convince that something is true. Rather, the goal is to locate your claim within precise and rigorous framework of accepted truth. So to answer the question, why does 1 plus 1 equal to 2 needs a proof anyway? Well, it's not really about whether it needs a proof or not. The point is, if we have a very firm axiomatic foundation of mathematics, the proof of 1 plus 1 equal to 2 comes as a byproduct. Our goal in this video is to see how, based on some fundamental axioms, we can formally prove something as elementary as 1 plus 1 equal to 2. But before that, let me introduce you with the infamous piano axioms. Piano axioms are a set of axioms for the natural number, first formulated by Italian mathematician Giuseppe Peano by the end of the 19th century. These axioms are effective in defining natural numbers and their properties, including operations like addition, multiplication, and equality relation. Almost everything we know about basic arithmetic can be deduced from these few axioms. Now, let's go back to our statement that we want to prove: 1 plus 1 equal to 2. we are going to assume that we have no knowledge about natural numbers or addition or equality. Try to forget all the intuitive notion that you have in mind about these concepts. We are going to define everything in this statement from scratch using piano axioms. Firstly, we have 1 and 2. We know that they are natural numbers. We also have an intuitive idea what a natural number is, right? The number that we use to count things are natural numbers. But our intuition is insufficient here. We must define natural numbers using piano axioms. So the first axiom that we have right over here is 0 is a natural number. So we are starting with first adding one element in the set of natural number. Now before stating the second axiom, we have to define the successor function. What is a successor function? Well, successor function is the function that sends a natural number to the next one. That means if we have an integer n, the successor function s of n equal to n plus 1. So we have s of 0 equal to 1, s of 1 equal to 2, and so on. The second axiom is, for every natural number n, successor of n is also a natural number. Our third axiom is, for all natural numbers m and n, if successor of m equal to successor of n, then m equal to n. That means, if the successor functions of two natural numbers is equal, then those two natural numbers are also equal. The fourth axiom is, 0 is not the successor of any natural number. That is, for every natural number n, s of n equal to 0 is false. That means, 0 is the smallest natural number. And the last piano axiom for defining natural numbers is the principle of induction. If a set K contains 0 and K contains the successor of every natural number in K, then K contains every natural number. Principle of induction is an extremely powerful proof method that can be used in proving a lot of general statements for all the natural numbers. I have a plan to make a separate video on induction to show how it can be used to prove theorems. Now these five axioms here are the defining axioms of natural numbers. For any number to be natural, it has to follow these five axioms. If you want, you can check whether the natural numbers that we know follow these axioms. Also, you can find out all the natural numbers just by following these five axioms. Now, let's jump into the next concept, addition. Addition is a function that maps two natural numbers to another one. In piano arithmetic, we define addition using these two axioms. For all natural numbers a and b, we have a plus 0 equal to a, and a plus successor of b is equal to successor of a plus b. The first axiom is quite straightforward. Let's see what the second one of these axioms mean. Let's say we have a plus 1, we can write it as a plus successor of 0, as successor of 0 is equal to 1, which is equal to successor of a plus 0 by our 7th axiom. And as a plus 0 equal to a, based on our 6th axiom, we can write successor of a plus 0 as successor of a. So we have a plus 1 equal to successor of a, which is consistent with our definition of successor function. Again, if you want, you can assume different values of a and b and check whether it makes sense intuitively. Finally, we are going to define equality relation. We are going to use the following four axioms to define equality. For all natural numbers a is equal to a. That means equality is reflexive. The word reflexive is just a fancy way of describing this property. What is the example of a relation that is not reflexive? Both greater than and less than relations are not reflexive, because A is less than A and A is greater than A are both false. Our ninth axiom is, For all natural numbers a and b, if a is equal to b, then b is also equal to a. That means equality is symmetric. Both greater than and less than relations are examples of relations that are not symmetric, because a is less than b doesn't imply b is less than a. Our next axiom is, for all natural numbers a, b and c, if a is equal to b and b is equal to c, then we have a is equal to c. That means equality is transitive. Both greater than and less than relations are also transitive, as it is true that a is less than b and b is less than c implies a is less than c, and a is greater than b and b is greater than c implies a is greater than c. And our final axiom to define equality is, for all natural numbers a and b, if b is a natural number and a is equal to b, then a is also a natural number. These four axioms are defining characteristics of equal relation. Now that we defined everything, we are almost ready to jump into our proof. But before that, we have to talk a little bit about something called the rule of inference. The rule of inference could seem like a very fancy name, but the idea itself is very simple. As a matter of fact, we always use it in our day-to-day life without knowing about it. Rule of inference is about reaching a conclusion based on some given or known information. For example, if I tell you that Tanya is my mom's sister, you can easily conclude that Tanya is my aunt. Similarly, if I tell you that X is not an even number, you can very easily conclude that it has to be an odd number, right? Another example is, let's say one of your friends cannot read anything without eyeglass. You can conclude that he has some problems with his eyes, right? One final axiom, which we already discussed before, if A is greater than B and B is greater than C, then we have A is greater than C. In all these cases, the rule of inference has very similar structure. If you know this, you also know that. So the rule of inference is about inferring something from something known or given. In mathematical logic, there is more meticulous treatment of the rule of inference, but for now, this understanding is enough. Finally, we are ready to see the proof. We are going to use our axioms and the rule of inference to proceed with our proof. Our common sense or intuition have no use here. Now, we know that based on the definition of the successor function, successor of 0 is equal to 1. The symmetric property of equality implies that 1 is also equal to successor of 0. So we have 1 plus 1, which is equal to 1 plus successor of 0, as we have already established that 1 is equal to successor of 0. Now we can write this 1 plus successor of 0 as successor of 1 plus 0 based on our 7th axiom, which says that for all natural number a and b, a plus successor of b is equal to successor of a plus b. Now this successor of 1 plus 0 is equal to successor of 1 based on our 6th axiom, which says that a plus 0 equal to a for all natural number a. This successor of 1 is equal to 2, because according to the definition of the successor function, successor of 1 is equal to 2. So we have 1 plus 1 equal to 2, which is what we wanted to prove. Now maybe some of you are wondering, this is such a small proof. How come Russell and Whitehead had to use 370 pages to write it? Well, to prove this, we used piano axioms to define every component of the statement, but we still took a lot of underlining logic for granted. But in Principia Mathematica, Russell and Whitehead developed literally everything from the ground up. If you want to see how they did it, I would recommend you to have a look into Principia Mathematica. The proof itself is still comparatively shorter in Principia Mathematica, but they spent most of the pages of that book defining axioms after axioms. That is the reason it took them so many pages to come to this conclusion. Now, to answer the question that we asked earlier, did Russell and Whitehead succeeded in establishing mathematics on firm foundational footing? Well, unfortunately, the answer is no. For example, in 1931, Austrian mathematician Kurt Gödel published his incompleteness theorem, which says that in any axiomatic system, such as the one in Principia Mathematica, there will always be true statement about natural numbers that cannot be proven, which was a revolutionary idea because before that, mathematicians used to think if something in mathematics is true, it would always be possible to prove it. But Gödel showed that is just not the case. So to sum it up, Russell and Whitehead were not really successful in putting mathematics on a firm foundation. Does that mean that Principia Mathematica was a failure? Well, the answer is also no. Even though it failed in some aspects, Principia Mathematica is still considered one of the best works on mathematical logic and the foundation of mathematics.